Welcome back, everyone. We're about to head into our fourth game of the day, and the Super Hot Crew may have more faith in SK Gaming than SK does, as Mr. Rawls and crew look to secure a win over their opponents and take them down.
SK, they are still really good, but they're in a slump, and I'm not really sure what their problem is.
Right now, it's pretty obvious that we're the worst team in LCS. I guess we lost our dedication, so we gotta play more.
I think we got cocky, and we stopped practicing, and now it's showing. So we're getting what we deserve right now.
Before they were winning, they weren't really improving. They were just staying really good because they were winning every game. And now that they're losing, they're just dropping in like motivation.
I think we need a win to get confidence back up, and hopefully we can take it from there.
From my previous experience playing against them, I didn't feel like their bot lane was that strong. I feel like me and Velez, since we've been playing more, like our synergy has definitely improved.
Super Hot Crew are on an up, they're motivated and they're better than us. When you're always chasing someone, it's easier for them to be more motivated and improve, so that's how they are.
Right now, I feel like it's more up to us if we win or lose. It's not up to our enemies. If we do good, we can do good. If we do bad, then it doesn't matter who our enemy will be. We will just lose.
Some big words from Freddy there saying, you know what? They're better than us right now.
Yeah, I think the biggest point they highlight is just how hungry Super Hot Crew are. Since the summer split began, they've been chasing the top teams. They've taken games off the top teams. And now we need to see if SK are hungry enough to bounce back.
Well, guys, it is time for our last LCS game of the day featuring SK Gaming and the Super Hot Crew. Wow. While both of these teams find themselves in the middle of the pack, you have to think that for SK Gaming, this is a big problem. They currently find themselves on a four-game losing streak, and this is a team that finished second in the spring split and had massive expectations for summer and potentially then Worlds. And they simply have not been able to keep up with the times and appear to be struggling more and more as the playoffs draw closer.
Yeah, that's the truth. The biggest problem for SK appears to have been the slump that they've hit. It has been running for 2 weeks before playoffs, and it's a big problem regarding timing because it's not exactly a recent thing. SK Gaming have been struggling for several weeks now, and it's spanned multiple patches. We keep talking about how SK's strongest champions have become less viable, but as a team, they just appear to have lost the strategic edge that they once had. That video just demonstrated that the team themselves aren't even sounding positive about their matches. I want to theorize that one of the reasons for their loss of control and presence stems from their very limited in-game vision. SK Gaming has the least amount of wards placed and purchased across all 8 teams in Europe. So to put things into perspective, SK Gaming have placed 1,922 wards, they purchased 387. Rocket actually leads the league with 2,276, nearly 350 more, and Fnatic has bought the most wards at 803, 430 more wards purchased in 22 games. That is a massive amount. And then just one player in particular who needs to be doing a better job at vision is Sven Skeren. He often plays aggressively, he likes to spend time in his opponent's jungle, and he actually buys and places the least wards out of all junglers in Europe. You can't play aggressively if you don't have vision to back it up.
And on the other side, the Super Hot Crew find themselves in a slightly different position. They ended the spring split having some flashy games and generating some buzz around their potential. And in summer, they've actually really stepped up their game to match that as well. From great strategic play to securing defining victories over the league leaders. The problem, however, for the Super Hot Crew stems from their inability to play consistently. They struggle against different teams at different times and still make catastrophic mistakes, which sometimes cost them games.
I couldn't agree with you more, Joe. The Super Hot Crew have actually blown me away at different times. Their ability to control laning phase, or their very strong team fights in some games. They've even got great minion wave management when they want to play the map. The list goes on, but the problem is they don't have all of these things all of the time in all of the games. When we actually look at their stats in wins and losses, the biggest thing that stands out is just how heavily they rely on kills in their victories. So if you contrast their 12 victories this split, you'll see they've secured 200 kills, average team KDA 7.5. But in their 10 losses, they're nearly a third of the kills at 77 and only 1.37 KDA. I think both of these teams have had their ups and their downs, but for SK Gaming, it appears to be a steady downward trend, whereas for Super Hot Crew, it is related to inconsistency in terms of finding those kills or avoiding those big mistakes. Selfie in particular has cost the Super Hot Crew several matches this split already.
Seems to be a real all or nothing player. And for the Super Hot Crew, we can hope that it's an all game for him today. Let's check out, though, first of all, before we get to the game, the starting lineups. On the blue side today is SK Gaming with Freddy in the top lane, Svenskeren in the jungle, Jezzus in the mid lane, Candy Panda the AD carry, and Enraged the support.
And on the red side, it is the Super Hot Crew with Mimer in the top lane, Impaler in the jungle, Selfie playing the mid lane, Mr. Rawls and Kasing as the AD carry and support.
So let's tally up the votes then at lolesports.com and see which team you predicted will win. With 51%, just a little advantage, the Super Hot Crew appear to be the bare favorites for this game. Very, very close though, and well, it all comes down to that, the fact that you don't know which Super Hot Crew team is going to turn up. And the SK have shown us moments of greatness, but not for a little while.
Yeah, I agree with that. And I think for both of these teams, the laning phase is going to be very, very important. SK Gaming have traditionally been a team that lost laning phase but bounced back because of having smart strategic moves, but they've lost that strategic edge. Something that we talk about, you know, off air is how the rest of the teams in Europe have sort of caught up to where SK Gaming were. And Freddy himself in that video is like, we're not really practicing, we got cocky, and they've let themselves fall behind. And they need to regain that. And I think it'll stem from a laning phase. If they get ahead, they are a team that can close it out. But they need to actually make sure they get that first.
I like the fact at least that Enraged says it's about us, whether we win or lose games. That shows already that, you know, SK Gaming are seeing that the problems in these games aren't that they're possibly being outclassed, but rather that they're not making the plays that would afford them those victories. We'll see how they've really adapted over this last weekend. We said a four-game losing streak is what SK Gaming are currently on. Let's talk about, though, the picks and bans. 4.12, no Lucian. Does that affect this game?
I wouldn't say so. I mean, Mr. Rawls has played a number of champions. Lucian is one of his most played. But we've seen he can play a multitude of AD carries. One of the few LCS AD carries that actually can play Draven and has in the past. I feel like the jungle bans and the jungle picks should be where the focus is in this game. Because both Impaler and Svenskeren are fairly swingy in terms of their performances. So let's see if we're going to once again see those slightly different picks, Jarvan and Riven from the previous game.
Well, let's have a look. We are going to see Yasuo out as the first ban for SK, and not a big surprise for us either. If you look at the last two games that the Super Hot Crew played, the win over Rockat, the loss to Alliance, both had the enemy team banning out Yasuo against Selfie. Kassadin also taken away. Don't really need to dwell on that one.
Yeah, we need to see where the priority is going to be for these mid laners. Jezzus is expanding his champion pool. As somebody who played a very large amount of Kayle and Nidalee and Ziggs in the past, going to be switching around. Selfie's very excited at seeing Twisted Fate banned out. Truthfully, Jezzus' Twisted Fate last week against Millennium was questionable. And it's all mid lane focused, so all three of the primary junglers are still up. Lee Sin and Elise are there for both Svenskeren and Impaler if they want to go that route.
So what will the Super Hot Crew be banning out against SK? Already taken out Kassadin, which we can't read too much into. Gragas, though, will be taken away. We've seen time and time again that if Gragas does manage to slip through those bans, then the likelihood is he's in the first round of picks from either side. And what will SK finish with? Already two bans aimed straight into the mid lane at Selfie. We've already said it that he's a very much hot and cold player. Sometimes he'll go absolutely crazy and be racking up kills left, right, and center. Sometimes he'll die far too much, and it is going to be another mid lane ban. Fizz taken away.
So it's all about the mid lane. All of the priority top laners and junglers are still up. And I've had a thought regarding Mimer in the top lane. He's tended to play tanks more than bruisers. Whereas Freddy pulled out Nidalee last week, Freddy's been playing a lot of Aatrox. Freddy likes to play the bruisers, the damage dealers, more so than Mimer does. We've seen a top lane Maokai earlier today. That's a champion that could fit his playstyle if he wanted to go that route. Xerath is still up. And the reason I highlighted is considering the amount of mid lane bans, as is Orianna. I kind of feel like one of those two could be considerations later in the pick ban phase, because it does sort of suit both Jezzus and Selfie's playstyles. The Orianna a little more for Selfie, I feel.
Are we going to see Braum locked in here? We are going to see Braum locked in. So Enraged getting his champion as the first one out. We actually saw him play it last week in that loss to Millennium 3-3-15. He ended up in that game. So first pick on the support. Interesting one for me. That gives Super Hot Crew now two very strong picks, surely.
I also feel that's a little bit of denying it from Kasing. Kasing has played more Brown than any other champion at 5 games, and I absolutely love his presence with his with Brown's ultimate, the Glacial Fissure. Kasing has changed team fights by throwing that down. So I do feel that there's two sides to that coin, but you are 100% right. All of the primary top laners up, all of the AD carries, with all of the focus on mid lane bans, both of these teams are really taking their time. This is one of the longest pick ban phases that we've had today, and we're only in the first round of picks here for the Super Hot Crew.
Well, we will be seeing Tristana locked in for Mr. Alls. I say for Mr. Alls. We have seen mid lane Tristana over in North America, and Jarvan the Fourth also picked up for Impaler. Now, Impaler, of course, has played that a couple of times in the past. However, last 2 games that he played last week, both of them were on Elise. So something a little bit different, at least, if you compare what he's been playing in the last week or so.
And also very hit and miss with Jarvan.
True.
When you think of Impaler, he is a fairly aggressive jungler. And I'm not entirely sold on his Jarvan ability. In the previous game, Cyanide had moments of opportunity where he could have gone in. And maybe if Impaler sees the same opportunity, he may pull the trigger. He may actually jump into those team fights. Once again, you do have peel, you do have protection, but SK Gaming really taking their time. Super Hot Crew still have to decide on their top laner, as well as their support, and may potentially leave that mid laner for later down the pick ban phase.
Well, they are going to be locking in jungler and AD carry this time around, and it's going to be, I say jungler, very much a last second switch away there. Maokai picked up, we have to say, we've seen him in the top lane here today, we saw him last week in the jungle out of Cyanide. Also, you know, the safer one here is Corki for Candy Panda, and look at this, Super Hot Crew are hovering over AD carries there as well.
I don't know if they're going to pull a curse. I don't know. Look, the Demacian standard flag that you rightly pointed out in the previous game increases attack speed of allies. So if you do put it 2 in there, you can theoretically shred a whole lot. The other side of the coin is SK Gaming with this Maokai lock-in, you don't know where it's going to go. You can't be 100% certain it's in the jungle because we have seen a top lane and we've heard from a few of the European teams that they're using it top lane. It's not merely a Rockat thing. So picks and bans going through, 10 seconds left on the clock. If Super Hot Crew do go with a double AD comp, it's all about the early to mid game. They need to make sure that they get towers in control early. If they fall behind and they get jumped on by Brown, by Maokai, in the early to mid game stages, they can be in a lot of trouble. But of course, if the game goes super late and Super Hot Crew were able to kite, it could work out. But decide to not lock in that second AD carry yet.
So Shyvana and Morgana it was then. So kind of typical picks here in the top lane and support role. That surely means that SK are going to go with something safer in this mid lane, not knowing if that Tristana may or may not go into the hands of Selfie, whether that will be for Mr. Oz, and they've just been baited into something on that front. We'll have to see though, because Aatrox did slip through the banning and the picking phase up until now. It's been a big favorite of Freddy. Jezus, Ziggs, a champion that he has gone to time and time again, and will do so here today as well.
Yeah, hovering over the Xerath, deciding what they wanted to go for. SK have got a good combination of wave clear, they've got a fairly strong front line. I think there's a good mixture of everything here for SK. Having Jezus on a fairly safe farming wave clearing champion like Ziggs is, in my opinion, his strongest style of play. And I think we've seen better games out of Jezus on that style of champion than elsewhere. And of course, Freddy's gone to a Golden Oldie, a favorite. But with both Maokai and Jarvan locked in for the jungle, we've completely foregone the trinity of junglers. We're slowly moving away from the Twisted Fate, from the Lee Sin, Evelynn and Elise in terms of champion picks. So we need to see how this works out. Super Crew deciding on their mid lane. They're not going to go for their double AD. So I got a little excited for nothing, Joe.
It's going to be Orianna versus Ziggs. Which is, yeah.
Oh, we've never seen that before.
Oh, or maybe not Ahri. We should talk about Ahri here because we have seen looking through a bit of what the players have been playing this week. Ahri herself did get a little buff and seems to be coming back into favor.
Yeah, the most important thing to note is that higher ability power ratio on her Q, the Orb of Deception. It should allow Ahri to wave clear somewhat more effectively. And on the assumption that Selfie can land those charms, there is insta-give potential on Ziggs, on Corki, maybe even on Brown in the early to mid-game. So Super Hot Crew have also got themselves a fairly well-rounded composition with Mima having Shyvana for the 12th time this split. Super comfort pick out of 23 games now. going to be looking to get control in the laning phase, going to be looking to split push, and then having the roaming help of Selfie either to the top or the bottom lane to pick up those kills. It's good to see Ahri. It's going to be interesting to see how she handles the laning phase. Ziggs should outrange her and should have more damage thanks to his passive and the bonus magic damage on his auto attacks. But we need to really see how Selfie plays that lane out.
Yeah, and how the changes have affected Ahri, whether we're going to see her coming back into real rotation. There was a time where it was a lot of Ahri. A lot of Ahri in the mid lane. We'll find out, though. But guys, with those picks and bans, do you still think that the Super Hot Crew will take the victory here? Tweet at LOL Esports with the hashtag SKWin or hashtag SHCWin, and we'll see if those lineups did manage to change your mind somewhat. It was a very slim line.
I was
going to
say,
51-49.
Do you think Super Hot Crew is going to win? 2% of the people thought that. This is the closest vote that I can actually think of, 51-49, that we've had this split. And both teams have got very strong compositions. I think the wave clear is slightly stronger, slightly safer on the side of SK Gaming, but they need to make use of that siege power, siege potential, if they want to. Corki, of course, short-range ADC, so it makes taking towers slightly more difficult than with the Tristana.
And less safe. Let's find out that we are going to get into game SK versus the Super Hot Crew mid-table clash. As we've said before, SK on a four-game losing streak right now with the Super Hot Crew. Well, hit and miss, I think, is a safe way to really describe how things are going with them in terms of form. We'll see, though, here today, as we said, this one's such an important one with those all-important playoff seeds up for grabs.
Well, for both of these teams, they're going to be looking at every other team that they're competing with. So, for example, on the side of the Super Hot Crew, a victory here actually ties them up with Millennium. Whereas for SK Gaming, a victory here ties them with the Super Hot Crew in the standings. So we're going to come down to those last matches in Super Week to determine who's in third, they play sixth, and who's in fourth, they play fifth. And Joe, we may have some loved tiebreakers at the end of Super Week.
I really like tiebreakers. The more the merrier is my philosophy on that front. We'll see though, because there's still, whilst it's a smaller number of games to be played, things can change and we see how close it is. Just one win or one loss here and there can really separate the teams at this point. See here the start for SK Gaming, Svenskeren with the Maokai, following in Cyanide's footsteps from last week. We'll be throwing out those saplings for a blue buff start, aided by Freddy. On the other side, it seems like we will be also seeing Shyvana with Mima headed towards that top lane after he's helped out Impaler on the red buff. That also means then, of course, that Standard in the middle and the duo is headed down bottom.
Yeah, we'll need to see how Enraged and Candy Panda hold themselves. I mean, Kasing in the pre-match video was fairly confident. I mean, he said he's not really threatened by Candy Panda and Enraged, and they've moved themselves up aggressively. I think Kasim's going to take a big chunk.
Well, nice little face check in there. Luckily for him, didn't get stunned up. Mr. Rawls actually trying to put the damage back, but not really got too much power to him at this stage. So early blows coming out from SK Gaming, being aggressive in positioning on that bush area. We'll see now then where the junglers go. Obviously, red and a blue both starting top side of the jungle. As again, Candy Panda and Mr. R is going to be exchanging things out. That's a lot of time spent in the pool as well, which is never good for your health bar.
I was just about to say, I actually feel like Candy Panda and Enraged, if they can get a full complement of spells down, should be able to outtrade Super Hot Crew. But you've seen how much damage Candy Panda took just from the Tormented Soil, as well as the Explosive Shot from Mr. Rawls there, just ticking away his HP. So Candy Panda's already burned through his potion, and he's going to be looking to control the wave. It's all about the Dark Binding here for Kasing. Candy Panda didn't even dodge that.
Didn't even really try to dodge that one. Was a bit of damage back, but Candy Panda continues to suffer somewhat. Already used his single pot there. As Mr. Rawls himself will go up and ward. They've already spotted Svenskeren here thanks to that ramp ward on the top side of SK's jungle, and that means that they're not going to be too scared about what's on the plate and what they've got to offer. Svenskeren, of course, did do both of his buffs, continues on his farming way. Similar thing for Impaler, he's making his first recall.
Yeah, we'll see where which lane he decides to impact. I know I keep talking about the AD carry lane, but if you look at Kasing's mana bar, he's burned through almost all of his mana, throwing out those bindings and those tormented soils. Now that he can no longer cast spells, Candy Panda and Rated may have the opportunity to trade back or just try hold their own a little more in that laning phase. Freddy, at the moment, he's farmed himself up ahead of Mima. and he shoved that wave in fairly effectively.
Well, good thing is that Kazing's basically traded his mana bar for the health bar of Candy Panda, and once that first pot already gone, no big amounts of sustain going to be coming in from him there in that bottom side. We'll see if the Super Hot Crew try and push an advantage in that bottom side of the map. Mid lane, which we've been quiet on up until now, Ahri for Selfie against the Ziggs of Jezzus is bang even after the first few waves.
Yeah, they're going to keep themselves even for the time being. The fact that Selfie's going to have that Spirit Rush available at level 6 means that he should, in theory, not be killed by Jezzus. The three charges, the mobility to dodge, you know, the Satchel and the Mega Inferno Bomb, in theory, gives Selfie kill pressure in that lane. But it is very dependent on landing those skill shots. And I'm also interested to see if Selfie's going to rush a Death by Grasp as a first item, which is something that we've seen from Ahri's in the past. The important thing to note there is that if Super Crew can maintain control of the blue buff, if you don't go for any sort of mana regen items, it does make life fairly difficult for you on Ahri. Although, Orb of Deception has a low mana cost now, 4.12, so maybe that'll play into Selfie's favor. We did notice in the bottom lane, Candy Panda recalled, picked himself up the makings of a Phage and another Potion. And what we haven't seen from Candy Panda in Rated is any aggressive play from in Rated. They have been under the poke damage of Mr. Rolls and Kasing, the Dark Bindings and the Tormented Soil, so Candy Panda is being punished. And I think if he wants to regain some control, landing the Winter's Bite from in Rated, getting a stun down and, you know, landing some more skill shots aggressively might be the way, but of course it can't happen if Impaler comes in from behind.
It's a good ward there into the brush though. I don't think Impaler's really going to be able to get around, only level 4 at this point. Do you really want to go under a tower? Oh, they might not need to. Svenskun throwing the sapling over. He's going to spot them coming in, but the charm has landed as well. Svenskun has to flash away. Impaler going under the tower, and Svenskun's gone aggressive onto him. Will that be first blood? Impaler does get it. He will fall straight down, though. That means first blood going over to the Super Hot Crew, but Jezzus getting one back.
Yeah, I think gold is more important on your mid laners and your junglers, of course. So well played by Impaler and Selfie to actually get in position to punish Svenskeren, but they didn't manage to get the kill. Now, my man Freddy, they're going toe-to-toe.
Yeah, level 6 there for Freddy. Wasn't able to get on top of him. Didn't actually use the ultimate there, so Mima did hit 6 just as he was able to walk away. And there is the vote, 68-32. And that is definitely a swing from the 51-49 we had from lolesports.com earlier. Super Hot Crew apparently favoring, or the favored team right now, possibly with the Ahri pick in the mid lane here for Selfie.
Well, it definitely seemed to work out in the jungle. Impaler just playing super, super aggressive, actually flashing to get another auto attack down onto Jezzus and actually pick up that kill. So it worked in his favor. And now we need to see how they roam around. Now we need to see how they impact the side lanes. Completely even in the top, completely even basically in the mid lane. And it's only Candy that's struggling for SK Gaming right now.
See how that one all works out. We see that both mid laners are going towards the Athenes first, so no DFG rush for Selfie. That one assist will help things out as Mima also just went back to pick himself up the Cutlass and will return into this top wave just in time to not lose any of that farm onto the turret itself. Freddy done a good job, as we've come to expect from Freddy on Aatrox. Does hold a slight lead, but the next wave should be able to balance things up, with Freddy actually headed off home, picks himself up Vamp Scepter and a Chain Vest here early on.
So he's gonna try and get some sustain in that lane and continue to stick around. Trading teleport. So Mima used his a tiny bit earlier, and extended laning phase from both of these teams. The head-to-head matchups, you know, top v top, duo v duo, does tend to extend the laning phase, and it also usually means later dragons as well, because of the fact that one team doesn't have that numbers advantage in the bottom half of the map. So we'll see who attempts the dragon first, but for the time being, call it bang on even in terms of overall gold. Another team with a strong advantage.
There's Selfie getting his blue buff. We questioned that earlier on whether he goes CFG. That's a lot of damage actually coming out from Jezzus. Landed a full combo onto Selfie. Both of them, of course, already passed that level 6 point. So ultimate's available. And Jezzus just coming off cooldown there. So he obviously used it in that mid lane before he went back earlier on to pick up the workings of that Athene's Unholy Grail. Here is Impaler just waiting off to the side as well. There is a good scan. That will reveal the vision out of SK Gaming and may set them up. There are pings off towards the dragon. Candy Panda also going a little bit low in the mid lane. That could be the signal to start that one off. Let's not forget that both top laners did initially just use that teleport, so that's not available. And Impaler here on Svenskun doing a bit of damage, but actually I think finding that he's losing out in that trade and decides to back away. He doesn't have vision inside of the brush there, and it was Svenskun who smited it off that big ring.
Yeah, if Svenskun had jumped in, then Selfie would have been there. Top laners, they're going toe-to-toe.
Yeah, Freddy actually popping his ultimate from this one. Bloodwell to rely on, Flash still available, which isn't for Mimer actually, so interesting use of aggression there out of Mimer. Freddy still holds on to that CS lead. Similar story in the bottom lane, it remains even in the middle lane as well, so focus on farming so far, very much the priority in this game.
Yeah, and I think until we hit maybe 11, 12, 13 minutes, we may not be seeing any sort of attempts for Dragon either. That's usually sort of your standard Dragon timing in straight up lanes. Mr. Rawls has also yet to back. So he's been in control of the lane for a prolonged period of time. He's actually built up 2,500 gold in his back pocket to spend in comparison to the 1,600 from Candy Panda. Of course, Candy Panda did back earlier from the onslaught that Mr. Rawls and Kasim were putting down, but he's only 10 CS behind. It's not a massive amount considering how dominant Mr. Rawls and Kasim were actually appearing with their two ranged champions against the melee and range of Corki.
Yeah, just a couple of hundred gold overall, which is, funnily enough, the amount that's separating these two teams right now. So we see that main difference does come from the AD carry.
And he is
and there he is going to be in trouble. Charm actually coming out. Svenskun going to go towards Selfie. Actually flashes away into the brush, and that will mean that he can't escape that one. But again, moving into territory that didn't have vision in there. And you rightly pointed out at the start of this game that SK aren't keeping up with other teams when it comes to the amount of wards that they're actually placing. And that has come to cost them in the past.
It has. They were lucky to get away with Svenskun's life this time around. And it was also good to see Selfie hesitating.
Oh.
He still had charges on his Spirit Rush and didn't manage to use them. Attack move obviously not being used by Impaler in that scenario. And SK lived to ward that part another day.
Poor old Impaler. He's spotted out the entire time, goes back off to his jungle. We have finally seen Mr. Rawls head back home and spend that massive gold that he'd earned in these first 11 and a half minutes. BF Sword and Pickaxe is going to come back with into the lane. Could be painful for Candy Panda if they don't watch out.
Yeah, I think it can be. Candy has obviously got a little more damage now with that Sheen, so dance time for a moment. Burst damage a little more in favor of Candy Panda for the moment with the Sheen, if he can get multiple spell reels off. Because one of the things that does work into Mr. Rawls' favor, if he combos the explosive shot with the rocket jump, with a buster shot on a target that may have been hit by a dark binding, there's actually some kill potential and bursting out from the side of Super Hot Crew. And Candy Pan has eaten a multitude of dark bindings this game already. So he really needs to pay a little more attention and dodge those skill shots. But he has been farming relatively well, still only 10 CS behind.
And especially with 2 points in queue in rapid fire for Mr. Rawls up until now, that's 45% attack speed for 7 seconds. If they end up getting into a fight, that's a lot of damage that could come out with that BF sword and that pickaxe from those auto attacks alone. Meanwhile, Impaler here on the top side of the map. Jungler's not really paying too much attention to this top lane so far, funnily enough.
No, they really haven't. In the bottom lane, though, Enraged's gone in.
Oh, actually jump away there from Mr. Rawls. Kasik popping his ultimate. That will block Enraged from moving any further, but not quite the damage to be finishing anything off on that front. And whilst they went for the aggression, losing a little bit of health on their way, no kills happening. Still was sat at 1-for-1, but the ultimate, of course, was brought out of Kasik.
So that's actually quite important, because if SK do get themselves into an aggressive position with that Glacial Fissure, they can be the ones to jump forward. But Rated gets held in place by another good Dark Binding from Kasik. He's hit a lot of those skill shots this game, so all credit to him. But landing phase continues to extend. So we're getting to the point where we tend to see teams considering the Dragon. 13 minutes on the clock, Mr. Rawls and Kasim may be feeling a little confident at the lane. If they push it out, you know, towards SK's tower, that could allow Super Hot Crew to move into the back and maybe go for a Dragon. We'll see how they handle themselves in the next few minutes.
SK not able to finish off that pink ward there and will actually end up losing their ward. for their troubles. We did see Impaler coming down towards that bottom lane. Svenskeren actually there as well. I think Impaler's finally found that pink ward as Mimer and Freddy once again going to go head to head. And there's the ulti coming out. As we see there, Freddy now in all sorts of trouble as if Bloodwell is going to get popped, but Mimer decides not to go underneath the tower.
That was such great reaction from Mimer. Using the Dragon's Descent to cancel the Dark Flight meant Freddy couldn't get away. So Freddy does not have his flash available, and Mimer with the Blade of the Rune King, in comparison to just the Cutlass and Chain Vest, means that he is now ahead, and he won that trade completely. Oh, that was confident from Selfie. Managed to miss that charm, unfortunately, since Jezzes gets away with his life. Take a look on the side. Svenskeren, you may want to go in.
Oh, they're going to come in for this one. Charm actually going through. Selfie will actually flash away to the backside. He's going to get some damage back onto Svenskeren. Can Impaler get in there? There's a Cataclysm use. Impaler will pick up that kill, but Jezzes going aggressive and surely will be able to finish. It's a Satchel Charge that does it. Almost takes Selfie with him as well. Another bouncing bomb comes through. The ultimate was used earlier, so nothing more. But it's a one for one, both junglers go down.
It is a near mirror of the very first kills that appeared on the map, just slightly further up the lane. That was actually very smart from SK because they punished Selfie for his aggressive move. Because Selfie used the Spirit Rush, it just allowed Svenskeren and Jezzes to stick to him and prevent him running away. So Jezzes picks up his second kill of the game. He's got the Sorc Shoes completed, got the Athenes. So he's a full Sorcerer's Shoes ahead of Selfie. Well, I take that back. Selfie's working towards the DFG, I believe, as his next item. Opted to go for the Athenes, which is probably the safer, smarter option in this scenario.
Let's see if once that DFG starts to get closer, whether he can actually build anything up and get some kills on the board. Currently two assists, obviously helping out Impaler with his two kills, only to see Impaler then go down and his opposite number in lane, able to take those kills for himself. Is ahead though in farm, which is always a good thing on Selfie's front. Top lane farm is pretty even. If you look at the bottom lane, more interestingly, I think as well, let's not forget Mr. Earl's had a healthy lead there. That's now been brought back towards a more level playing field.
So it's one of those things where at lower level, Candy Panda being melee, was bullied and pushed around by Kasing, who's Morgana obviously with the long range dark bindings and auto attacks. But as SK's bottom lane has got levels, the kill threat has grown, and it looks like Mr. Rolls and Kasing are not looking to dominate or punish that lane quite as heavily. So we do see them pushing the wave out, but there's very little damage on that bottom lane tower, actually. So Super Hulk crew happy to farm, but not necessarily looking to take the tower. And if they realize that Kenny Pen and Raiden are gone, Super Hulk crew could go for Dragon.
Dragon at this point wondering why he's still alive and no one's really got involved onto him. That may change here though with the recall, as you see now the Super Hot Crew starting to move into position. The bottom lane, or at least the AD carry, won't be there. Candy Panda went back, finished off his Trinity Force. We do see Dragon going low. Svenskeren's off to the side, but he's already backed away. Bouncy bomb! Ooh, that was really close, but the Super Hot Crew did manage to finish it off.
So they started Dragon and Impaler didn't have the smite available, but they do manage to actually get the one after the bouncy bomb closes. An advantage to Super Hot Crew, so they seem to be slightly ahead in the laning phase. Mimer was bullying Freddy. We've seen Mr. Riles and Kasing bullying Candy Panda and Enrated, and Selfie has played aggressively against Jezzes, but hasn't really completely come out ahead because of the fact that every time Impaler ganks, Jezzes walks away with a kill. But it's all about the mid lane for both of these junglers. They've basically ignored both top and bottom.
Yep, may actually be roaming up towards that top side. Mr. Oz now taking a lot of damage as well. That's a good dark binding onto Enrated, but got to be scared of Candy Panda. That Trinity Force proving once again that it's a little bit too hot to handle. And Mr. Oz being forced to back away. As once again, the blue buff's going to be given over there. No real challenge out of enemy mid lane or jungle. Both sides of the map, really, when it comes to these blue buffs spawning in. So the farm continues, approaching that 20-minute mark. We have seen the first dragon of the game go to the Super Hot Crew. Now finally we're going to see some roaming. Selfie is coming towards this bottom lane. There is Kasing trying to get in. Who are they going to go for? The charm actually missing, and the damage split across both AD carry and support, neither of which went down.
Don't land the skill shots, don't get the kills. So Selfie with the first roam of the game from that middle lane, unable to make anything happen. And this extended laning phase, while it has been very passive, is not, oh, that's a cancel teleport as well. So they defend the tower, but of course, Mimer's teleport's on cooldown now. And the one thing I want to highlight is that both of these teams scale fairly well. Mr. Rolls and Tristana is obviously going to have a slightly easier time in team fights than Corki will, thanks to the longer range and the buster shots. But once Maokai gets tanky, once Aatrox gets tanky, it's going to be a strong front line for both Jezzes and Candy Panda to spam away damage, and the poke of Corki and Ziggs is very frustrating to deal with. So whoever can start to play this mid-game slightly more strategically might be able to actually pull ahead. Super Hot Crew with a small lead for the time being, but here comes Svenskeren from behind.
Coming in from the side, that's a good binding from Kasing. Will that be enough to keep them safe on this front? There's a flash in, Svenskeren going aggressive on this one, all to use our Mr. Oz, but Kasing's going to go down, and it's Enraten that picks up the kill.
Very, very well played. They knew that Kasing did not have his Soul Shackles from the previous gank attempt. Flash had been used as well, and Svenskeren just punishes Super Hot Crew for basically failing their previous engage. So well played by them. Kill goes over to Enraten. And back to the lanes, back to the extended farming. You have to feel that unless a team groups for a tower, the next fight may only happen around the dragon.
And this has been a bit of a typical style, I think, from SK in particular. We've seen that they're quite happy to farm and farm and farm and rely on those later game decisions. Something that at the start of the split and at the end of last split they were doing really well. Something in the last couple of weeks though that's fallen away from a little bit. The Super Hot Crew themselves, we've also seen them having leads going into the late game and making catastrophic mistakes which have then cost them. So some similarities maybe to be drawn from this match.
On the same token, SK Gaming have also been bullied in the very early game last week and the week before, where they've been quite honestly obliterated and removed from the game before the 20-minute mark.
Yep.
So SK are looking stronger in this game, despite the fact they have actually been behind in top and bottom. You know, Candy Pan has been bullied, still behind on CS. Freddy has been bullied, still behind on CS. It's not massive amounts, but you cannot deny the fact that Super Hot Crew has these marginal advantages, and here's Top going toe-to-toe once more.
Oh, Freddy this time though feeling a little bit more confident with that Blade of the Rune King in there and the workings of his Sunfire Cape, and I don't think Maimon wanted to go too heavy into that fight there. And we're now going to see Jarvan and Ahri headed down towards his bottom lane. Awarding the Death Brush though, will in fact spot Selfie coming out, and already see that SK backed away from danger.
So there was no vision for the Super Hot Crew in the top half of the map, which is why I think Impaler didn't go more aggressive, playing it safely. And he wasn't really trying to fight. It just looked like Freddy was going all in anticipation of a battle. So Impaler snuck himself into this bottom half of the map. Svenskeren's coming in from the side. And this could turn into a 3v3, but in the top, there goes Freddy and Maimon.
Freddy and Maimon going at it once again. Maimon will use his ultimate. Freddy's ulti wasn't actually available there. And Maimon using his Blade of the Ruined King just to get that extra speed. Candy Panda actually landed a rocket onto Impaler, which Impaler then said, okay, I'm just going to leave this one. Backed away, but Svenskeren has waited around this entire time. He's looking to get in there onto Singh or Mr. Rolls. Feel like Kasing probably the easier of the targets, but Impaler, after the recall, will come back down bottom as well. We could see a 3-on-3 fight break out.
So towers traded now. Both top lane towers are down. SK and Super Hot Crew's top lane is somewhat unlocked. Look at Mr. Rawls. We'll see if he's in trouble.
There's the damage coming in. Svenskeren going to go in. It's Kasing that they are trying to focus down. He's very, very low. TPs are going to come to the bottom lane as well. Svenskeren running around in circles here, and now he's the one in trouble as the bomb does come around. That may be enough just to save his life. All of a sudden, SK are 5 men in the bottom lane.
So with Dragon up and available, all of a sudden, both teams are willing to commit a lot of resources. Charm does not connect. SK have peeled from the bottom lane, and they are looking to go for Dragon. Look at ultimates. This is the key. There is no Soul Shackles for the Super Hot Crew, no Mega Inferno Bomb, nor Glacial Fissure. So in terms of actual fighting power, I believe Super Hot Crew have a slightly stronger situation. SK may agree, and they're going to trade tower for Dragon.
Not a bad trade-off here. The Super Hot Crew will be taking that Dragon down, but the mid turret does fall in favor of SK Gaming. See how that works out. Second Dragon in the game, and of course both of them on the Super Hot Crew side. Impaler actually on top of a pink ward here. Needs to be a little careful. Use the flag and Dragon, get back off into the Dragon pit. Just to make sure that he doesn't get caught out on that one. Actually didn't quite get the pink ward either. It's been a pain for him so far this game.
It really has been. Not the end of the world. Super Crew may trade the towers. Oh, Candy Panda, he's got no mana.
He's got no mana, he can't do anything here. Mr. Arzo is taking up the tower, and Candy Panda gets one. Will he get the second? No. Impaler was able to get out. They did get that kill onto Candy Panda. Freddy and Enraged then finally coming back around to save the turret. Mr. Arzo, I think, expected that Impaler was tanking that one up and didn't quite see it as he jumped in.
Yeah, it's uncharacteristic of Mr. Arzo, really. Obviously, he didn't have his summoning heal either in that, thanks to the previous fight where he needed to use it and save a teammate. So, Candy Panda gets his first kill of the game, manages to punish Mr. Riles. He's fallen slightly further behind in CS, and we see Sorcerer Shoes being picked up by Candy Panda. It's something you see on Corkies fairly regularly, thanks to the high amount of magic damage they deal. But again, it's just fights around the dragon for these teams. They have not really committed to rotations, dare I say it, as it is just been straight up head-to-head laning. And I feel with all of the teleports down, and I feel with the towers now falling slightly quicker, we may now see these teams starting to roam and move to the other lanes slightly quicker than we have been seeing.
You're very optimistic, Quickshot.
Gotta hope for the best.
Well, SK are at least stacking up three men here on the bottom side of the map, so looks like they're going to be trying to at least pressure that one. We'll give them a 3-1 turret lead if they can actually finish this one off. They need to be careful, though, because there are three men doing exactly the same for the Super Hot Crew on that middle outer turret. And there we go. They force Mimer back, and that will be turret number three for SK Gaming. Nicely done. Quick execution on the tower kill.
So this has just been a straight-up skills game, with both teams having standard lanes and waiting for junglers to really impact. Impaler and Svenskeren have put all their focus in middle. Now, Mime is off on the side lane. He's blue buff, rather. So he's away from the rest of the team. And SK are fairly well grouped. Here comes Mime for the fight.
Well, he's ulted in, and the rest of the Super Hot Crew are focusing. Svenskeren off on the side. Mr. Ross here is going to take damage and actually has to jump away because Sing is low as well. This could be real bad news overall. The slope and the maybe stun could come onto Mr. Ross. Actually, Jezza splashes in. They actually land the satchel charge, and they're going to keep going. They have finished off Candy Panda, so Corki is down. Selfie is now running. There's no tower there. He's going to have to pull a sneaky one here if he's to escape from this. He may possibly still do it. There's a flash in from Svenskeren, and there surely is the kill. It's Svenskeren that picks it up, and in the end, a 3-for-1 for SK.
The front line of SK is so, so difficult to burn through. Super Hot Crew started a fight, and they were split up. Mimer just dove into SK Gaming, but look at this. The rest of his team is half a screen away, and by time Mr. Al, Selfie, and Kassim move up, Mimer's already forced low and on the full retreat. So Candy Panda Jezza has completely untouched that fight, just allowed to put the damage down, and even with the buster shot, not hitting multiple targets, Mr. Alt, it just gets popped. So I think it was too quick for Mimer. I think he should have waited for his team to get in a slightly better position. SK Gaming even out the gold despite being two dragons down, and they accelerate in terms of kills.
Throwing a lot at Svenskeren as he was walking into that fight as well. You have to feel that a beeline straight towards the rest of the team could have help things out more for the Super Hot Crew. But that's all in the past. We're sat now at 7-4 for SK in kills. However, the Super Hot Crew still hold the gold lead. It is a minute one, though. Only about 200-300. 3-1 tower lead for SK Gaming. Dragon will be coming up again in 2 minutes' time. And that, as it has been so far, will surely be the next melting pot of action in this game.
Look at Selfie's build. Deathmind Grasp, as well as that Void Staff completed, along with the Ethereum Holy Grail. So if he manages to catch out Freddy, Jezza, or Candy Panda, they don't have the highest amount of MR. And I think he can put a lot of damage down. But we've not seen Selfie land a lot of charms. You know, he's tried to use the Spirit Rush into charm combo 2 or 3 times this game, and we've been left a little wanting. So we'll see how he handles himself. For the time being, Super Hot Crew now playing defensively. They had dragon control, but they haven't won the team fight that has followed. So that's definitely going to be promising for SK Gaming. You can see they're grouping themselves up and they want to siege this middle lane.
See that Freddy actually went for the Rando into your first one. Dark Binding coming out, forcing the Valkyrie there from Candy Panda. Direction on it was good. It's all about pressure here for SK Gaming, keeping that bottom and middle wave as far up the lane as they can with the impending dragon. 43 seconds until that comes up. You see that Selfie still hanging around the side, so still looking for any kind of position in all advance. He's been able to catch anyone out, but that ward will spot where he is. And SK quite happy to put down as much pressure as they can onto the inner turret until the dragon spawn.
So if Selfie's not at the tower, they're relying on the explosive shot from Mr. Riles to really clear out the waves. Selfie's got the only sort of safe wave clear. And now let's see, 2-on-1, can they get Freddy? Charm doesn't land, but they're still going for it.
Well, he's now going to push in from that one. Freddy is already low and will get that Bloodwell pop. Question is, have they got enough damage? They will have enough damage. There is an easy Charm. Selfie picks that one up, but what's it going to cost them here? They've left three men to defend the turret in the middle. And look at this, Impaler going to go aggressive. They've locked Svenskeren in underneath the turret, but is Svenskeren the tankiest man there on SK Gaming? And he will walk away with still half of his health intact.
Manages to get away cleanly. Impaler forced to flash out of the risk of dying. But you see how quickly Selfie blew Freddy up. Even without landing the charm for the bonus damage, the DFG and the lack of magic resist up until now, the Spectre's Cowl, melted Freddy's HP bar. It's all going to be on Selfie to pick off a target in these team fights from the sideline if Super Haku want to get a commanding win.
The dragon's going down. There's nothing that SK are going to be able to do about this one. That will be another one for the Super Hot Crew. Dragon pickups really keeping them in this game. They're behind in kills, they're behind in turrets, but securing all three dragons leaves them with a 2,500 gold lead with 30 minutes on the clock. Look down some of the other items here as well for Jezus, who, by the way, is at 401 with over 300 CS. Zhonya's Hourglass, Athene's Void Staff, and has now got another blasting wand, which are expected to come up as a Zhonya's, as a Ramadan's death cap here shortly. Selfie, meanwhile, has taken down the second turret of the game for the Super Hot Crew. Freddy not feeling confident about getting too involved without his Bloodwell.
So you have to feel that it's now on Super Hot Crew to make the plays. They've been playing very passive for 30 minutes, and Impaler's put his focus in that mid lane. The few times that Selfie tried to roam, it got countered quite effectively. So that may have been where one of the big stall buttons came from for the Super Hot Crew. But as it stands, they've got some very big item thresholds. Infinity Edge plus Static Shiv for Mr. Riles against the Trinity Force Bloodthirster. So Candy Panda's got very good sustain, but he still needs to get in close. He still needs to get into charm range from Selfie. And I think if Selfie catches him out, that's just going to be an instant teamfight victory for the Super Hot Crew.
Well, SK starting to push up this middle lane once again. It's hard to say that Baron might be a priority here soon because this game has worked on a different time scale, I think, to what we're used to seeing, a very passive lane phase. Not all that much action in it. Both teams really focusing on getting farmed up as quickly as possible. The numbers really reflecting that. Both mid laners above 300 CS, top laners are approaching that point. AD carries aren't far off it either.
When do you ever see a top laner at 300 CS in 30 minutes in this day and age? It's very, very unusual because of the prevalence of sort of lane swaps and the inability to have this extended laning phase. On the same token, we talked about how both of these teams are in the middle of the pack. SK have been struggling for recent weeks as they're 0-4, and Super Hot Crew are very up and down. So when you've got a team that's inconsistent, one of the best things to do to prevent mistakes is just play safe. So again, I just think playoffs around the corner, it's an important match. Neither team wants to give up any objectives by making big mistakes. And Mr. Rolls, again, Lost Whisper picked up. This is going to help so much against the very tanky targets SK have put in front of him.
Yeah, completely agree with you on that front. We saw it in Alliance versus Fnatic as well, that neither team wanting to make any silly mistakes. This is interesting though. We see that Mimer is actually behind SK right now, and he's going to be waiting in a position where SK have no vision. That's good damage towards Selfie though.
Now, the last time Mimer came in from the sideline, it didn't work out too great for Super Hot Crew. They split up, they can't defend the tower, and Mimer is still not moving. But Selfie has backed off, so he's got full HP. If Mimer engages from the side, if he can flank and get multiple targets, and then Impaler follows up with Cataclysm, it would work well. Didn't happen because SK has strategically moved away already.
Yeah, they spotted Mimer as well, who was behind them, and SK would be happy with that quick move towards the turret, take it down and push straight up through the jungle on towards the top side. However, Impaler is now waiting in that brush off to the side. Selfie will be pushing out middle. Let's see if the Super Hot Crew feel like fighting for this one. Six always going to be a problem. A 4-0-1-6 Ziggs with 350 CS, even more of a problem, possibly a Selfie coming in from that side again. Mimer now waiting. They are actually going to be going in onto this one. Candy Panda Valkyrie away from things, and they seem a little bit apprehensive. There they go, they're going to throw everything at Svensson. He doesn't go down. Is that a bad news here? Selfie off to the side. He's been kept out of lots of damage. Freddy will get his blood well popped. Selfie now going to come back over once again. The charm came through, didn't actually land, and such a big, prolonged team fight, landing a 1-0 for the Super Hot Crew.
So when Rated actually prevented that being worse by throwing the Glacial Fissure down in the top, he made it so difficult for the rest of Super Hot Crew to engage through that very powerful slow. They blew a lot trying to kill Svenskeren, and they had very little left for the rest of the fight. But Super Hot Crew, they get the kill, they peel for mid lane tower.
Can they get it here? SK only have Corki there. He's going to have decent wave clear. And we see there just pushing out Phosphorus Bomb. Freddy will actually TP in there as well. So SK being pushed away after losing the one man. Selfie still waiting. And that all-important timer, I think this game more than any, the Dragon is coming up in 120.
And so important to note, because Freddy was forced to teleport to the mid tower to defend, he's not going to be able to jump into a Dragon fight if and when it breaks out. So Super Hot Crew will have that information, and they should throw Mime into a side lane to try and make pressure elsewhere on the map. We'll see if they can play it that way, because Mime hasn't had the best of times split pushing for probably the last 10 or 12 minutes. Freddy has been more capable of dealing with him in those 1v1 shooters.
Yeah, which was a problem earlier on for Freddy, but since the addition of that Blade of the Rune King, Randoin's now finished as well. They'll be just chunking lumps out of each other and able to both back away, I think, when the time calls for it. But Dragon gonna be the important one here. 35 minutes on the clock, still the Super Hot Crew lead this one in gold. 3,000 almost by now. Dragon is the next important thing in this game, and the Super Hot Crew already trying to make positional ground.
Yeah, I also want to highlight that because Selfie's got less angles to come in from the side to catch somebody out, it might be more difficult for him to get a full combo down. In the straight up open areas, he hasn't landed most of the charms. And part of the reason they killed Svenskeren in the top is Selfie was hiding in the tree line. So we'll see how they play this out. Candy Panda's nowhere near, so SK do not want to fight yet. Candy's getting his own red.
I have to question as well whether a full combo, DFG and all, onto Svenskeren is really what they need to be doing. We'll find out here as that Dragon is going to be started off, finished quickly there for the Super Hot Crew. SK couldn't do anything now. And Mime is in the mid lane, so they can't even push straight up there.
With Mr. Rawls, damage build, Infinity Edge, BF Sword, Last Whisper, Static Shift, he melted through that Dragon so quickly. And because Candy Panda wasn't with the team instantly, SK was so hesitant to start the fight. Super Hot Crew extend their gold lead, but the problem is, they'd have to deal with the Ziggs. So even though Super Hot Crew seemed to be in the lead, seemed to be in control somewhat, it's so difficult to get towers down. It's so difficult to break through that very powerful wave clear of Ziggs and Corki. So if they don't get kills, it's, I don't want to say impossible, but it's unlikely to secure towers quickly.
Let's have a look down some more items then while we have another brief respite in this game. We see the Rabadon's death.
It won't be too brief, Jeff.
Well, possibly not. Dragon's up in about 4 minutes. That's when we've got. Rabadon's death cap is the next item here for Jezus. Obviously, on the other side, no death cap because of that DFG start for Selfie. There's the Mega Inferno Bomb. Actually, a lot of damage there onto Selfie now. Still couldn't quite finish off that tower. We're too afraid of getting involved. We do have Mime pushing the bottom lane. TP available for him. On the other side, Freddy has no teleport available. They've chosen to actually send Candy Panda down there, which, without the AD carry, Super Hot Crew might actually fancy that 4v4, especially since Mime has got TP.
Yeah, I do agree with you. And on the same token, part of the reason is because Candy Panda is fairly far behind. Impaler, he's got it!
They got it, and Mime is coming around the back as well. They're alone for now, though. Here is Selfie trying to get in. He's going to go for Freddy, who's still got his blood well available. Didn't even need it there in the end. He's burning from the Ignite, but will get away. But that's finally the opening on the turret that they need. Good damage back. Glacial Fissure, it's nothing there, sadly, for Enrated. And his Super Hot Crew take a tower, back away, no kills.
One tower for almost, a whole bunch of ultimates, as well as a teleport, as well as Impaler's Flash. Yes, Super Hunker got the objective, but it took so long to get ready from 100 to 10%. They didn't even get his blood well at the end of the day. So this is boding well for SK Gaming, if they can pick a team fight, and if they can have Candy Panda with them. But Super Hot Crew, they need to get Selfie onto the right target. He blew everything on Freddy, and it wasn't enough.
And that's the funny thing about how this game has gone so far. And now, most games that we're used to seeing, you'd say not worth all of those ultimates. everything piled onto one man not to kill him. However, in this one, because he's been slower, because those turrets have been more difficult to take down, that one turret at this stage may be worth all of that. We'll see now, because SK are trying to get a bit of a hold on the Super Hot Crew jungle, getting a few wards down by the red buff. Look at Kasing trying to cause a problem for them there. Impaler was around as well, and Selfie is now pushing this bottom lane out. There's no one to deal with him just yet. Freddy does have teleport and should be coming down there. Jezus is actually pushing out that top lane as well.
Yeah, there's actually two members of SK moving down towards the bottom half of the map. But it does look like town was already taken. So smart play there from Super Hot Crew. They send Selfie down. The wave clear from that orbit deception that we talked about. Higher AP ratio. He shoves waves very, very quickly. But in the same token, it's the inhibitor turrets that count. There are still two inner turrets standing for SK Gaming. They still have Ziggs to turtle and defend. So SK have made some positive moves, but it still feels relatively small in the grand scheme of things.
I'm trying to catch Mimer out there, but he just hops away. Burnout running, not really a problem for him. Solal's defending as well. Impaler actually off to the side. Svenskeren going to phase check him, but I think they've learned the lesson from throwing everything at Svenskeren here. Impaler decided not to go through again. Selfie looking like he's going to head towards his bottom lane for somewhat of a split push. He needs to be careful though with everyone from SK, except now Freddy, who's gone towards the top lane but does have the teleport available.
So there's two things that SK can try if they wanted to. Baron would be a possibility to peel and then fight, but it's actually Super Hot Crew that look like they're starting to engage. And they've got some good damage on Sphere.
They've gone very, very deep here, but this could be bad news for them if they're not careful. Impaler will actually slide away. Freddy going on towards Mr. Oz. He's been slow, and Freddy doing a great job of it. Kasing gonna go low. They're focusing Mimer first of all, though. He will actually flash away. Black Shield comes in, or Dark Shield comes in. No, Black Shield, that's the name of it. Now it's up to Selfie to come around the back. Is there anyone available for the taking? He could kill pretty much every single one of them, I think, if he lands a full combo. However, SK, they're going to try and bait out Baron. They're going to try and take the Baron.
They know everybody from Super Hot Crew is low except Selfie. So you can see Mimer has already backed away. No teleport for him. Look at the rest of SK. They're on the Baron. Impaler is aware of it. But if he jumps in here, he may just get instantly blown up. Selfie looks like he's going on a long walk around. He's gone through the blue buff area of SK. Baron,
they can't do this.
It's only at half. It's going down so slowly. Super Hot Crew may have a chance.
Yeah, and Impaler actually throwing another flag in there. We'll see that one. Here comes Selfie from the side. He blows up Candy Panda. The Baron's still alive as well. SK not able to finish that one up. Enrated goes low. They're all diving in, but it's Mimer that's tanking them all. Mr. Oz at the back as well has now flashed. Gets himself one. He's going to get a second onto Jezus as well. That's a double kill coming out. And just like that, SK lose four. Freddy's going to get his blood well popped here eventually. He was trying to take out Impaler. There's enough damage though to finish him off. Can he take out Impaler in the end? No, he can't. See, ace for nothing for the Super Hot Crew.
Super Hot Crew at 40 minutes. Wait for SK to take an eternity to deal damage to Baron. And it wasn't going down. SK just stuck around. You've seen how quickly Selfie can blow somebody up when he comes in and lands the skill shots. 20 seconds left on the clock. A little bit of split decision making here. Mimer was thinking inhibitor, rest of the team's thinking Baron. And that is a massive, massive swing in control. SK with Baron and a 10k gold lead. It's now up to them to find more team fights. So look at Candy. Charm didn't even connect, and it wasn't even needed.
Nope.
Burn through summon a heal, burn through everything they had. And the most important thing is just SK Gaming stuck around. They were not blowing Baron up, and Super Hot Crew waited, what, 15 seconds at least, maybe a little longer, before they decided to move in and just cleaned up the house completely.
See here, once again, the push onto Impaler, great binding. Pretty much last second, there was a lot of health to come back up, and a good knock up, that Black Shield coming in, and just too much damage, 4 versus 1 there. Super Hot Crew got the Baron, they're going to take a Dragon, and all of a sudden, it's 13,000 gold lead.
It's just, bad decision making from SK.
See, because we got 43 minutes on the clock up until this point where both teams have played so careful, for me, it makes very little sense that SK would try and force it on that one, spend so much time on Baron, lose so much health. We've already seen time and time again that Selfie has not been with the rest of the team. He's flanked around almost every single time. He's been trying it this entire game to get in there. And if he gets it, he's managed to sneak all the way around the back, get the DFG off in a full combo almost, except the charm, onto the AD carry. I don't know, bad decision here from SK Gaming, and you have to feel that's the, you know, enough to tip the scales.
On the same token, SK may have had the opportunity to peel and get a target, but it was far too late. You know, Supercrew played so passive, they didn't go in to challenge for Baron, they didn't panic. And that slow approach may have thrown SK Gaming off. Now SK have to play a massive defensive game. Yes, they have all of this wave clear that I've pointed out multiple times, but the threat of getting caught by a Dark Binding or a Charm means that you are potentially just gonna get blown up. And in a 5v4 scenario, hell, I think Super Hot Crew would die. They are a team that plays aggressive. They are a team that plays a little bit fast and loose. Teleports up for Mima. So Selfie's pushing bottom. I expect Mima to push top, and they're gonna try break that last inner turret in the top lane.
And this is what we heard from Selfie, I believe, last week when he said, you know, I love to play aggressive. I like to play a little bit risky sometimes. And I think Ahri is the kind of champion where it can certainly work out for him if he's able to get in on the flank. Same time, if they lock him up while he's trying to flank and the rest of the team aren't there to give him any protection, it could be the opposite story. But that last fight there, not that it was really much of a fight, that last cleanup from the Super Hot Crew. Yep. Once the AD carry's gone, it's just a matter of time, especially when you have Ziggs who had zero mana left once that fight started.
Very, very true. And you know, Selfie's most banned champion is Yasuo. He very seldom gets to play that. Yasuo is a very mobile, in-your-face assassin, much like Ahri. So he's got the mindset, and he's got the ability to play it. So, top inner turret, secured for Super Hot Crew. They're going 1-3-1, and they're extending their lead.
Now, look at that graph as well. It's so, so close for half an hour there. And you see just the sharp drop that's gone down towards that 15,000 gold lead mark, which the Super Hot Crew already have under their belt. Selfie continues to split push off. Can he find it? Oh, he's gonna get dove on. There is the kill. And that's what happens.
Well, flash charm. That was a great play. Super Hot Crew with a 5v4. They're on the inhibitor turret. They are tower diving.
Oh, they are tower diving here. Jez is going to be the target. There is the cataclysm coming down. Jez's ultimate does really nothing to them. Jez is actually still alive in there somehow. And now Mr. Ra's going to join in. This is surely the cleanup crew. Freddy on top of them. Kassing actually falling pretty low. Jez does get that kill. And there is Freddy jumping out once his Bloodwell comes back up. Super Hot Crew not exactly getting kills there, but they don't care. They've won positioning on the first inhibitor turret and the inhibitor in the mid lane, and now they're going to take the second down bottom.
Super minions in two lanes, plus the ability to, you know, tower dive. Look at the damage. Mr. Ralls untouched. He's still going in. I don't know if they want to finish yet. They've got a few minions to play with, but this is very, very aggressive.
It doesn't matter. Selfie able to finish that one off, and Mr. Ralls is just hammering away on the turret. See how much damage he does. And Selfie once again dives in to get the double. Can he get the triple here? He's going to move forward. No, yes, shut down by Jezus. But Mr. Ralls has taken down the Nexus turret and will focus straight in on towards the Nexus itself. Jezus going to try and hold him off here. Not sure if he's got the damage. Apparently he does. Impaler, Mr. Ralls, Mima, all backing away. Panda's going to try and chase through. There is the Mega Inferno Bomb. Comes down and they do get the kill. Four men are dead here for quite some time for the Super Hot Crew. Are SK going to try and push it out?
They've got such a difficult time if they want to. With super minions in two lanes, it's going to be next to impossible to deal with the minions as well as get multiple towers. Mima's still alive, so he can Dragon's Descent into the middle of the team and try wave clear, but it looks like Candy Panda and Jezz's definitely pushing up through that middle lane. And I do take it back. When they were under the Nexus towers, I just watched the fight against Selfie. Did actually land the Charmander and Rated and blew him up. Absolutely melted him. So super minions plus Mima plus Kassing to deal with. SK peel away from the mid lane.
Not able to go all the way there. I thought they were going to try and push back, but takes a while to push up that middle lane with those super minions coming down. Leaves us at 14-11 in kills. Shows us how action-packed, in terms of kills in these last few minutes at least. Let me put that disclaimer out there before I go and proclaim that this was a action-packed game. Certainly not the first half an hour, but it often escalates very, very quickly.
Well, the later you go, the more items you have, the easier it is to just clean house. Especially when you give Super Crew the option to have positioning on you in the Baron Pit. So, SK Gaming, you just have to feel it's a matter of time before Super Crew group up and push them down. And if Super Crew do it fairly smart, they can wait for the Super Minions to get to the Nexus, which is exposed, and then simply keep them busy with a team fight. Allow the super minions to do the work. Looks like they may consider going for Baron. It will respawn in 50 seconds. And we just need to see how confident they are to finish the game. Selfie, 8, 2, and 3. DFG, Hourglass, Voidstaff, and a Lichbane. His burst damage is through the roof right now.
We have seen, though, the Super Hot Crew make mistakes where they've been ahead in games before.
You've got to make a monumental mistake
in this game. But have they or have they not made those mistakes before?
No, they have. I do not disagree with you. However, they made those mistakes in what were fairly even games. You would have to make a plethora of catastrophic mistakes to give away a 17,000 gold lead with super minions in two lanes. I believe the term is very optimistic there, Joe.
Well, one can hope sometimes. I don't know. Selfie, he's the man that could make the mistake. That's what I'm trying to get at here. We've seen him trying the flank time and time again. Granted, it's worked most of the time for him here. However, if he gets killed off early, there's still hope for SK Gaming. I'm sticking to my guns on that front. Well, Baron is going down here, which makes that a lot harder to achieve them.
Yeah, one of the things that SK's comp doesn't necessarily do too well, unless Sven Skeren locks down Selfie and Jezzes uses his full burst combo down, they actually don't have your traditional bursty mage or assassin in that comp. But again, if they do, they need to make sure that SK can immediately peel and deal with Mr. Riles. He is the man that's been winning the team fights previously. So, middle inhibitors respawn, bottom will be done in just a few seconds. Super Hot Crew with Baron. Oh, Charm got Freddy. And there goes Selfie.
Yeah, DFG gonna be used there, but we see no. Well, didn't blow him up. That's what I was trying to get at, Frank. Freddy already a little bit tanky. We see he was struggling with the super minions earlier, actually lost half of his health pretty much, trying to keep that bottom lane pushed out. We need to be real careful about this one. We've seen already Selfie not scared to flash DFG Charm and just throw a full combo at whoever he likely catches from that one. They're going to try and get in there, finish off this inhibitor. Now with Mr. Oz moving in. There we go. They're going to go for Mr. Oz. Where's the damage coming from? Mr. Oz will actually rocket jump away. Impaler's in the middle of them. I think the Super Hot Crew are going to try and back off. Selfie almost being chunked down there. The Sven's going to get bound up. Candy Panda, meanwhile, he's chasing Mima. They've held it off for now.
Are you a believer, Joe? Can SK continue to defend? They managed to catch Super Hot Crew when they were split up. Mima was not with the team, and Sven Skeren used a flash engage onto Mr. Riles, but they didn't get the kill. Summoner Heal was used, as well as the Mikhail's Crucible, and Mr. Riles got a big chunk of hit points back, which allowed him to get away safely. But again, Super Hot Crew have just got such a massive lead. As long as they group up, they should theoretically be able to win these team fights. And they didn't use any of their ultimates here. Selfie, once again, has Spirit Rush available, whereas Jezzes does not have the Mega Inferno Bomb for a few more seconds. It will be up in 5 or 10.
So, though, how fast, if things land, Selfie, Mr. Oz, the two key components of this team for the Super Hot Crew. See how fast they went down. Selfie can 100-0 pretty much anyone. Now, and there he is, he's going for Jezzes. Oh, he's pulled the Zhonya's, and now Selfie uses the Zhonya's of his own. Can he get away from it? A lot of damage coming on through. Will they keep chasing? Mr. Oz running unchecked on the top side and will actually jump away himself. Svenskun surely going to fall. Selfie that gets that kill. Freddy having his Guardian Angel pot. Can they get any more from this one? Mima the next target as they try to hold them off. They force Corki to Valkyrie away. They're having to flash through as Freddy gonna get his blood well down, and that itself is together kill, and the Super Hot Crew push through and pick up the win here over SK Gaming after 52 and a half minutes.
0-5 for SK as we approach the second to last week in the split. Super Hot Crew with a shaky mid game managed to pull it back, and stern looks there on Freddy's face, not happy with that game.
Well, it's a 5-game losing streak now for SK Gaming. At exactly the wrong time of the season. Exactly the wrong time to be on a losing streak here. Everything so close in that mid-table area. This is exactly the time where you need to be going even, picking up more wins than losses, and SK in bad shape.
I completely agree. They're stumbling down from finishing second in the spring split to being fifth or sixth. We'll do the math in just a moment, but it's not looking good for SK. For Super Hot Crew on the other side, they had a strong laning phase. It went on for a long time, and they had a tiny advantage throughout most of it. They had fairly strong team fights. They closed the game out in the late game, you know, a little hairy at points, but they played it safe and they finished it. And Selfie again with a big performance. 10-2-3 on RE on 4.12 after the changes. You can argue just how good it was, but it was good. He got a lot of kills. Yep. He found the targets when it counted. And that's what matters.
And that now surely adds another champion to the must ban against Selfie list.
Not sure if I'd say must ban.
No?
Must consider to ban. The reason I say that, if SK had been slightly more on point in terms of punishing the split push or whatever, you know, when Selfie was down in the bottom lane, Super Hot Crew picked a fight with SK in the mid lane and then sort of went, oh, we're kind of losing this. This may not have been the smartest of choices. If SK had been proactive and punished, they could have come out ahead. But they didn't, so it didn't work out for them. But I do agree it was good. It has to be a consideration. But I do still feel Selfie is still stronger on champions like Yasuo.
So for SK Gaming then, as I said, not peaking at the right time, troughing at the wrong time is probably the official way to say it.
It is now, anyway.
It is now, at least. What's going wrong for them? Is it a mindset thing? We heard from Freddie in the pregame video. We've seen Freddie after the game there. They look real down at this point.
You have to think that is the primary concern. Because of the way they played in this matchup, in the laning phase, they felt slightly behind. Wasn't as bad as we've seen in previous weeks, but they didn't make super proactive plays. Didn't really look for team fights. Only once Super Hot Crew jumped on them did they commit. And then the Baron call, that is a monumental mistake. They stuck around. It took a very long time to get Baron down. And instead of bailing out safely early or peeling for a fight, they waited for Selfie to get in position, waited for Selfie to go in, and then sort of went, actually, guys, we don't want to be here. So mindset, I definitely think, is a core problem. And they're going to have to talk to their sports psychologist to try and solve this problem. I mean, they have somebody on hand, and they need to make use of the resources.
It's funny how it works out, really. The only team, to my knowledge, that have that at their disposal, and they're the team that you would probably say in the league that are actually looking the most in need of that position. Either way, it's tough times for SK Gaming. Good times, though, for the Super Hot Crew. And we're going to send things over to Shox and Deficio, who are joined by the Super Hot Crew's AD carry, Mr. Ross.
Thank you very much, and congratulations first off to Mr. Raleigh after that hard-fought win versus SK Gaming. Take me through the picks and bans. A lot of mid lane bans, and I think maybe surprising, SK banning out a lot of things that I would assume they wanted to first pick. So how did you guys react to all those bans?
First of all, we planned to ban out Fizz ourselves. But then, we kind of prepared for blue side because before we were blue side. And then we realized that we were actually purple side into the game. So we kind of just did fast picks, and it was kind of random, and I think we got outpicked as well.
Well, you play Tristana. Lucian is now gone, 4.12. A lot of the European AD carries love to play him. For you, what does it change as an AD carry that he's gone now, and we have all these new AD carries coming up, and what is it Tristana brings?
I think currently Tristana is the safest pick. It's something you can pick very early, just like Lucian before you got disabled. I think Lucian is probably strong in mid lane right now, while I wouldn't really play him that much in bot lane because he's so low range and he can be tough to play in laning phase because currently it's all about the long range AD carries and it can be a tough time if you have to face against the Kog'Maw or Tristana.
Well, Tristana definitely is very long range at the end game approaches, but let's focus back on this game. You say the ban and pick phase was kind of random and unexpected for you guys, so how do you then work with those picks in the game? Because it took a long time, but then you guys kind of find your flow with those picks.
This game was really hard for us because we got outpicked, and it was very hard for us to do anything because they have stronger team fights. Like, we had to flank them, and we had to go 1-3-1 to even be able to siege. So it was kind of random what we did.
So talking about flanking, let's just bring up the very first replay. Around the dragon here, it's actually you guys who start the fight against SK Gaming. You are 2,000 gold ahead at this point. And Maima is, of course, trying to flank around here, but just try and talk me through the fight. Because it's a bit weird for me with Impaler being in the mid lane, and yet you guys seem to engage. So let's just roll the clip here.
Yes, I think overall the engage was really, really good. But I think we overchased it a little bit. We could just have walked safe out there and got our own blue buff. And instead we just got caught and...
Did it surprise you? Sventu and Kim from the side? Like, it seemed like you guys were walking in, he approached, and everyone's like, oh, what are we doing here? And you tried to bind him, it missed, and he'd engage onto you?
Yeah, I was trying to get some basic off, and then suddenly Sventu just came into my head, and I just couldn't really do much and W'd out.
So lack of wards, a bit over-aggressive with the engage, or...?
Yeah, it's a little bit of everything, but we definitely need to improve our ward control.
Let's actually transition straight into the next replay where things go a lot better for you guys is when they're around Dragon. Let's pull that up on the screen because SK was trying to get that Baron, but you guys didn't let them.
Yeah, again, so SK, they set up the Baron here. A bit of a risky one because you guys are staying around, but you did lose a team fight where Selfie had gone down to bottom lane and there was an engage. He joined in very late. He still has ult, he has everything ready here. But SK start the Baron. The communication right here, who's actually making calls? And you guys, are you starting screaming, go in, or is it very, very calm?
Well, the communication was that we knew Corki wasn't hitting the Baron, so it would be very, very slow. It would take a long time to do the Baron, and then Selfie was screaming that he was flanking them from behind.
All right, so let's just roll the clip at least so we can also see Selfie come in.
Yeah, so you can see Selfie come in and just get an easy kill on Corki, and then we pretty much just clean up.
And it must be the worst feeling as an AD carry, knowing an Ahri can actually come in and just destroy you in a matter of seconds.
Yeah, I don't like that Ahri is coming back, because I'll probably just get one shot at again.
Well, yeah, the curse of AD carries, you are the target always for an Ahri.
Yeah.
This teamfight for me actually seems to be the issue for SK Gaming, because they seem to make the wrong decisions when it really matters here. I'm not sure if you agree, but you guys in the past used to make some wrong decisions in the late game, which could end up costing you the game. Is it anything you agree with? Is it anything you guys have worked on?
Yeah, I definitely agree with it. It's something Nick has been helping us a lot with, because we used to throw a lot of games and make a lot of dumb decisions. But Impaler have been watching a lot of ODN games, and he's been getting way better at this, calling us off.
Well, you're definitely focusing on improving, and with this win, you actually locked in your spot in the playoffs, which is a huge improvement from last split. So what is the mindset now? Now you have locked that place in, and there is a really real chance, if you guys keep fighting, that you can make it to Worlds. So how is the atmosphere going around that?
Well, the atmosphere is obviously really good, but we are still trying really hard to win the next couple of matches, because there is still a chance for the second place, I believe. It's going to be really hard, and it's probably not going to happen, but we have to improve a lot if we want to be able to win against Alliance or Fnatic to secure Worlds.
Well, don't think that way. I mean, you got to win here, and it was very impressive, so we'll see where that goes. Thank you very much.
No problem.
All right, now we're going to send it back over to Joe and Quickshot for an update on the standings.
Thank you very much, guys. And with those four matches under our belt, here's where things currently stand in the European LCS. As you can see from the graphic, the following four teams have secured a spot in the playoffs. Alliance maintain control of their first place spot, while Fnatic have a comfortable hold on that second place as well. Millennium and the Superhot Crew have both punched their tickets to the playoffs and are also tied for third with 13 wins.
In the rest of the table, SK Gaming and Rocket are tied for fifth. They are heavy favorites to round out the playoff spots, but even though the Wolves are in seventh, there is still technically a chance for them. Unfortunately, Gambit is the lowest ranked team in Europe. Their playoff dreams are no longer alive, but they could still hope to pass the Wolves for a better seed in the promotion tournament, or to spoil the dreams of their rivals if they take victories off Fnatic, force them to third, for example.
And of course, on Friday, we'll bring you four more matches as teams continue to fight for those playoff spots, starting with the Superhot Crew taking on Gambit, and then SK Gaming face off against Rocket.
After that is Alliance versus the Copenhagen Wolves, Fnatic versus Millennium. After those matches, the EU Challenger Series begins as the veteran Ninjas in Pyjamas. And of course, they take on Gamers 2, led by Ocelot.
And that's all happening on Friday at 6 p.m. Central European Summer Time, which is 9 a.m. Pacific. But right now, ladies and gentlemen, it's time for the European Challenger Series semi-finals as H2K Gaming take on SK Gaming Prime in a best of three.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to week 10 of the European League of Legends Championship Series.
Yeah, Gambit, go!
Go Gambit.
Overpower does manage to use the Zhonya's, but he will get the kill onto Diamond. We see Genji going down, Rocket making all sorts of problems.
Please don't show that.
Follows straight in, gets straight on towards him. It's a great ultimate for Kevin. He just obliterates the Wolves there, and they were not expecting so much damage.
Nice. High five. All around. Yes. Nice. Good job, team.
There's a Canic Lizard, they're looking for Tab. He will flash away, and Cyanide is going to go down. Tab picks up that kill. There's another hook. This time one towards Frogger. Have they got the damage?
No pressure, but
We do kind of have to win.
Mr. Rawls at the back as well has now flashed, gets himself one. He's going to get a second onto Jezus as well.